let's look into checking the model assumptions with residual plots in simple linear regression. Recall our simple linear regression model, where y is assumed to have this linear relationship with x, and epsilon is a random error component, representing the fact that the y's have some variability and are randomly distributed about that line. To do any statistical inference, we needed to make some assumptions about that random error term epsilon. The error terms are assumed to be normally distributed, homoscedastic, meaning they all have the same variance, and they're assumed to be independent of one another. These assumptions may or may not be true, and so we should investigate them where we can. If these assumptions are true, then the observed residuals should behave in a similar fashion. Epsilon sub I would represent the true theoretical error term for the ith individual, whereas E sub I represents the observed residual that we see in the sample, the value of y for that individual minus the predicted value of y from the model. And if the assumptions of our model are true, then these observed residuals should behave in a similar fashion. In other words, they should be approximately normally distributed with constant variance for all the different x values. Strictly speaking, the observed residuals are not going to be independent of one another, but that's not really a big problem for our purposes. Here I've plotted the residuals for a simulated dataset against x. I could have plotted them against the predicted values, the y-hat values, and that would give us basically the same picture with just a different scaling on the x-axis. But we shouldn't plot them against the y-values. Can't plot the residuals against the observed values of y because they're related. So that would give us a misleading picture. We shouldn't plot that out. One thing to note right off the bat, that the residuals always sum to zero in simple linear regression. Those observed residuals are going to sum to zero, and that's why I put this zero line in for a little perspective, because the residuals sum to zero, and so they have a mean of zero. What we are hoping to see is simply a random scattering of points, nothing giving any indication that the assumptions of our model are false. So here, for instance, it looks like the variability is about the same at all these different values of x. The variability here is approximately equal all the way along. There also doesn't appear to be any curvature or just any other indications that there's a problem with our model. So I'm going to give this the big check mark, indicating that that residual plot gives us no indication that the assumptions of our model are false. Here's another type of plot we might see. At first glance, this might look a little bit different from that plot on the last page because we've got all these different measurements at these individual values of x. And we might see this type of thing in an experiment where we have some control over the levels of x, for instance, if we're giving a different dose levels of a drug or something to that effect. But here, it's a similar story to the last page. There's not really much going on here. The variability is approximately the same across the board. There's no systematic curvature, nothing indicating non-normality or anything of that nature. Overall, this is a very reasonable residual plot. A fairly random scattering of points. I'm going to give that the check mark, indicating there's no real obvious problems with our assumed model. In this residual plot, there's a more obvious problem. The variance of the residuals is increasing with x. And that's a violation of the constant variance assumption. This type of situation is not uncommon. It's not unusual in statistics for the variance to increase with the mean, so we do see this kind of thing. We do have ways of dealing with this. One option would be to possibly use something we call weighted regression to deal with this changing variance. But overall, the assumptions of our model are not reasonable here. So I'm going to give that the big X. Here's something that's a more obvious problem. There's systematic curvature in the residuals, and that indicates that that assumed linear relationship between y and x is not a reasonable one. We may be able to deal with this by using a slightly different model, but for now, this residual plot indicates serious problems with our assumed model, and I'm going to give it the big X. If we've recorded our observations in time order of some nature, then we should also plot that against time order. Here, there is something going on. Our residuals are small, and then they're big, and then they're small, and then they're big. There is some sort of time effect that has not been properly included in our model, and we're going to have to deal with that in some way. If we ignore it, that's going to be a problem. So this residual plot indicates there's something systematic going on, and there's a problem with our assumed model. So it gets the big X. Now let's look at a real-world dataset that we've looked at previously. This is activation level in the pain centers of the brain for 16 women versus their score on the empathic concern scale. And I've plotted in the least squares regression line. Let's see what the residual plot looks like. Here I've plotted the residuals against the explanatory variable x, and I'm going to say there's no obvious problems here. There's no systematic curvature, there's no major outliers. One could make an argument, I suppose, that the variance of the residuals might seem to be a little bit lower here than over here, but that's not necessarily an obvious effect here, and I'm not going to consider that to be a big problem. So I'm going to give this the check mark, that that's a reasonable residual plot. Here's a normal quantile-quantile plot of those residuals. If you recall, if the residuals are approximately normally distributed, then the normal quantile-quantile plot of those residuals will result in an approximately straight line. And I'm going to say that for a normal quantile-quantile plot, that's a pretty straight line. So I'm going to give the check mark there and say that the residuals are approximately normally distributed. So those different residual plots don't indicate any problems with our assumed model, and it would be okay to go ahead with some of our statistical inference techniques. Here's another dataset that we've looked at previously. Janka hardness versus density for 36 Australian trees. And we fit a least squares regression line through those 36 points, and it looks to be a pretty reasonable fit. But let's see what the residual plot looks like. Here I've plotted the residuals against the explanatory variable x, and there does appear to be some systematic curvature here. As well, one could argue that the variability over here seems to be a little bit less than the variability over here. So this residual plot is indicating a possible problem with our assumed model. And if we go back to this scatter plot, armed with the knowledge of what the residual plot looked like, we might be able to see that curvature here. We might be able to see, wait a minute, it seems to be doing something like this. But the residual plot makes that a little bit more obvious. The residual plot removes that increasing trend and then rescales the y-axis, so it's a little bit easier to see these issues sometimes in the residual plot, even though the scatter plot gives us basically the same information. So the residual plot has told us that there's a problem with the assumed model. Perhaps that straight-line relationship was a reasonable one to begin with, but the residual plot told us that it's not perfect and that we can probably improve upon it. To improve our model, we might consider adding an x-squared term to fit a curve through those points, or we might consider a transformation of one or both of our variables in an effort to come up with a straight-line relationship. But those are other talks for other days.